philosophers have tended to think about place as just another concept to add to the list of concepts that we consider. And they've tended to think about it in a fairly abstract manner. And I've always thought that that's really a problem with, for philosophers. I mean, we have been out of place. We have not known our place. We have not known how to keep our place or to stay in a place or anything like that. We've rather risen above and supposed that we don't have any place at all, as if we were floating around with the gods. And this is just not true. I mean, our concepts come from somewhere. Our concepts matter to people. They have audiences, they have sources, they have all of these sorts of things that are not incidental to their production. And so a great deal of what I've done in my own work has been to try and drag philosophy down from those heights and attach it back to the places to which it owes, as Derrida called it, its debts and duties. And that does not mean that philosophy gives up its search for universals or transcendentals or whatever you want to call it, but that it always does that in connection with somewhere that these concepts matter. And so this book that was just mentioned, Philosophy in an African Place, is an attempt to do that, to both work out a theory of place that matters to philosophy, but then to do that, to pursue that notion of philosophy within a place that is very self-conscious about its place, and that's African philosophy. African philosophy is conscious about its place because it has been told by Europe for at least the past 200 years that it's not capable of having a philosophy at all. It's not, you know, Africa doesn't have intellectuals, so they were told. And so, you know, this is, let me just tell you the bottom line, crap, okay? And there are a lot of very brilliant people over there trying to think about, what does it mean to think about this place? What are the concepts that matter here? What does it mean to talk about race here? Not America, not Europe, not somewhere else, but South Africa or Kenya. And those are two different, by the way. What does it mean to talk about other concepts? Tradition, for example. What does it mean to talk about any number of concepts that we philosophers think we know about, you know, we have some kind of abstract definition for, but in fact, the conversation becomes so much richer when we realize these people over here have a particular set of concerns and goals and community and all the rest of that, and it's different from the way that I learned it in the West. So for me, place is a very, very important notion, and in some ways it really is the central concept of most of my work, even though some of that gets cashed out within cultural philosophy and other places. So what I want to do today is to think about the notion of place within the context of architecture, planning, design. These are all areas that I see as having questions and concerns that flow back and forth. Those three certainly, and probably other places as well. Geography has possibly a hand in some of that as well. And so the simple question that I want to ask today is, why should place matter in architecture? And you might think, well, what a stupid question, because isn't that all architecture really cares about? Making places. But if you look at the history of architecture and the thought about architecture, until the last few decades, it's been more focused on the production of those places than it has in reflecting on just what it is that it's doing in the process of producing those places. There are architects now that have focused on some of this. I'll show you a few of them in a moment. But my premise here is that if space is the canvas for architects, place is the finished product. We start with a kind of undifferentiated space, and the question then is, what can be produced? And what I want to do today is run through some different kind of notions of place, because I think when we use the term place, we're not just talking about one thing. We're talking about a number of different approaches and a number of different uses for that concept. We tend to jump, you know, dump it all in one big bin and say, well, this is what place is. I think if we start teasing out some of the distinctions in place, we get something much more interesting going on. We can see some of the tensions, in fact, that exist when we start thinking about how we ought to build places, or how we perceive places, or how we experience them. And so, you know, we start with this sort of notion, but as I say here, it says nothing at all about what constitutes a definition for place. We can define places functionally, aesthetically, socially, technologically, historically, or probably many other ways. And so I want to nail a few of these ways down. So we're going to start with the basic question, is a strip mall a place? And one answer is, well, of course it is. It has location. It exists in you know, space, it has an address. Of course it's a place. How could it not be a place? Well, what's interesting when you think about places is that as soon as you start thinking about places, a number of other concepts come tagging along with it. Okay? Concepts like time. Okay? Place and time surprisingly have quite a lot to do with each other. If I ask you, I do this actually in classes sometimes. I have students go through a little exercise where I tell them, okay, here's the deal. You have to come up with 10 different answers to a question, 10 different answers, and then we're going to go around the room, and you're going to give me the answers. And the game is that you have to give a different answer than anyone has given to this point. And the question is this: where are you? Okay. And so people start writing down their answers. And we start going around the room. We get really the easy ones first. I'm in a chair, you know. I'm in Orlando. But as soon as you start thinking about the answers to those questions, I mean, they're all place answers, but some of them come inflected with time. Could you say 300, 400, whatever 100 years ago, I am in Orlando, sitting in this very geographical place? No, because Orlando is a temporally indexed term. There wasn't an Orlando 500 years ago. There is now. You could be in this very spot. So sometimes time comes with place. You might say, I am next to this person. That's another way of saying, where are you? I am next to this person, in front of that person. Well, that's a relative notion. John Locke talked about place in terms of a chessboard on a ship. And he said, you know, we say that the chessboard is in the same place even though the ship is moving across the ocean, because the chessboard has not moved from the table in the galley, let's say, or something like that. But the chessboard, of course, is moving, right? It's moving across the ocean. And yet, it's in the same place, because place is relative, right? We often talk about place as being linked to identity, right? I mean, when we think about place, we often think about people's particular places and why those places matter to them and which places do not matter, which places they do not even notice. Strip malls, you can drive by them because there's a million of them. It does not function as a place in that sense, because if place has something to do with significance, that may actually be insignificant. Of course, that's not what the strip mall designer wants. They want you to notice it. They want you to come there, right? Everyone is trying to figure out the way to get people to stop there and not just treat it as something that is on the way to something else, right? So I get all of these different answers from people when I run this little exercise, and it's really interesting because they run into a wall after about four or five of these, and they start thinking, huh, okay, so how do I give a different answer to this seemingly simple question of where am I? Where are you? But the fact is, you could give a huge number of these answers, and what you would find, we'll see in a moment, is that you're using place in a number of different ways. Okay? So in architecture, you have a bunch of people who have started thinking about that. You know, people like Eric Howe and Gins, and Venturi and Denis Scott Brown, and Bernard Tschumi, and Rem Koolhaas, and just a whole host of them. I've given you a whole list of these people, and many of these people have worked with philosophers or sociologists or others to co-write documents or design projects or do any number of things. Clearly they are being much more deliberate about the question of what a place is. Had to put a duck in there for Venturi and Brown, of course. If you don't know about ducks and decorated sheds, you should really read up on them. So how is the term place used? Well, I've grouped these in kind of three different kind of umbrella sorts of groupings. Sometimes when we talk about place, we're talking about particularity. We're talking about spatial location, the immediate or concrete. We may be talking about exclusivity. You know, this place is different from that place, or maybe uniqueness, right? So if we have an undifferentiated space where everything is exactly the same, are there any places? Well, there may not be, right? You need differentiation. You need something about this that is not like that to make that thing a place. It may be having to do with the static, the fixed, or the permanent, or the stable. So David Seaman and Ann Buttermer here wrote this book called Human Experience of Space and Place a number of years ago, and Seaman is the chair of architecture at Kansas State. So he comes very much out of the same world as you do. When he talks about place, he says, certain values almost inevitably fostered in stable, place-bound communities that are indispensable ingredients for a decent human existence. And so see what he's doing. Place has something to do with who we are, right? It's not just location in space or GPS coordinates, but it has something to do with who we are. So place can designate that. It can designate, as I mentioned already, relation or context. So Fred Myers, in a book called Pitupi, Country Pitupi Self, and he is an anthropologist studying the Pitupi people who are in Central Australia. He says, place is the embodiment of relationships among people. Places are imbued with the identity of the people who live there. So there's a kind of imprint, right? And you can probably recognize this. I mean, I bet you can go home and you can recognize your imprint. And you can go to somebody else's apartment or place, and you will recognize a different imprint. Maybe it will not be familiar to you, but you'll recognize there's something different. It's not like mine, you know? You can walk into your place and say, yeah, I'm used to this stuff. Pretty good, you know, everything makes sense to me here. Somebody else can walk in and go, oh my gosh, how do you live here? Or what a mess. Or, gee, isn't that interesting? Or something, because it doesn't fit the comfort, the familiarity. So place can have to do with relation. It can be about the local. It can be about nature. As I mentioned already with the chessboard, relations between things. You know, Barry Lopez does a great job on this. Lopez wrote a book called Arctic Dreams, in which he looks at Arctic peoples and talks about their sense of place. And if you think about it, you know, here are people who live in places that, you know, may be largely tundra. You know, we would go up there for the most part, if you're not familiar with that place, and say, it's all undifferentiated, right? It's all snow. It all looks the same to me. They can find their way around. It doesn't look all the same to them. Those places all have significance to them. Right? We don't read it, but they do. And then the third sense of place, and this is perhaps the most common one, is that place, space designates meaningful space. And so it's an open question about whether a suburban development like this designates meaningful space or not, or rather what it would take to make it meaningful. Right? Because this aerial shot looks more like an abstract painting than it does small town home experience. And yet I bet a bunch of us are from exactly that kind of space, and we recognize those spaces as in fact being meaningful. But when we're talking about meaning, we're talking about identity, activity, home, feeling, symbolic order, time, transcendence even, you know. So there are a number of different kind of uses of the term. I'm not even getting to the kind of theoretical definitions here. I'm simply talking about the ways that people use the notion of place. Right? I've looked at uses of the notion across probably 30, 35 different disciplines, and it is just, I mean, it's a term that just stands in for all sorts of things. Sometimes as a kind of resistance to previous theoretical approaches to the world, resistance to modernism in some cases, resistance to postmodernism in others, resistance to alienation, resistance to all sorts of different things, or has positive connotations as well. So it stands in for a lot of different things, which is why it's such an interesting term for a philosopher. So meaningful place, places feeling measured in one's muscles and bones, right? I know somebody who got off the plane in New York, in London, first time she'd ever been there, and she said, I'm home. I'm home. And she'd gone back there every year, 20 plus years. She just knew it just felt right. You know? And I tried to get her to articulate, what exactly is it that felt right to you? And she can never really quite do it. You know, she's not, her background is in English, it's actually German. You know? So it's not that, it's not some kind of, you know, cultural memory of some sort that was handed down at her mother's knee or something like that. It was something else that she was responding to. But I've met other people that just say, you know, they come to a place and there is a simpatico, there's a resonance for them. Place, Karsten Harries, who's an architectural theorist and historian, place can be seen as a creation of architecture whose purpose is to make the individual more embedded in the community and in the world. Right. So that for him is, in fact, the ethical function of architecture. That is how we can talk about architecture as an ethical enterprise, right? Which most people would not necessarily think of architecture as being. I mean, there are ethics within architecture, but architecture as being about ethics, well, maybe it is. Right? Maybe there are ethical and non-ethical, or better and worse ways to think about these things. What reaction or emotion is created in a place? Place creates a certain state of mind, which in turn elicits particular actions or behaviors. So much more kind of environmental psychology sort of approach. You know, you design the McDonald's for people to move through quickly, and sure enough, they move through quickly. They take on a certain consciousness based on the spatial and placial signifiers that they find there. So this notion of meaning is quite a rich one. We're going to come back to that. Now, as I mentioned, I want to talk about these kind of theoretical approaches to place, because I think once we see that there are different ways of thinking about place, it's going to become apparent that in a design project or any time we try and put some kind of meat to the bones of this sort of thing, we're really working with things that may actually conflict with each other, may actually undermine each other, may come from different traditions and need to be negotiated in some way. And so what I've done here, as I mentioned, I've looked at many different disciplines and looked at the way the concept of place is used. And what I distilled down was really what I thought were about four different kind of nodes of use. These aren't really, essential definitions or anything, but what I've called, firstly, the phenomenological and hermeneutical approach, and each of these I'm going to describe in a moment. Symbolic and structural approach, social constructivist and Marxian approach, and the psychological and determinist approach. And so there are these four ways, and so let me just run through these and give you a sense of what I think is going on with each of them. So we start with phenomenology. Phenomenology, for our purposes here, is going to be predicated on the notion that all of our knowledge and all of our understanding of the world starts from the fact that we are bodies within the world. Okay? That is our first place. Our bodies are our first place in the world. Okay? We are always here. There's nowhere you can go and say, I am not here. Right? You are always here because your body is where you are. And so that has implications to it. Okay? Traditionally in philosophy, we have tried to put an arm's length approach between ourselves and our concepts as if we are not implicated in them, right? The body is out there. The body is something we hold at arm's length and we think about in kind of abstract manner. And phenomenology starts from the notion that you can't do that. You just cannot put yourself at arm's length. There is no way you can do that. What we focus on instead is the question of our experience in the world. What does it mean to live in this world? What does it mean to experience it? And so some of the implications of this are that we are located in space, we're related to other bodies, both similar and not similar to us. We're not just inert matter, but we're bodies that act in the world. And so we're not just lumps of flesh, we do things, we have habits. The action is not indiscriminate, but it's habitual. Our action is free and yet constrained. And in fact, that may be a necessary linkage, right? We tend to think about freedom as something which is not constrained in any way, but think about a great basketball player. Okay? My hero was Michael Jordan. I am the following player. All right. Fill in your own favorite great basketball player. Could that great player be great if the game had no rules? If he could just walk on the court and say, my goal, apparently, is to get the ball through the hoop, and so I'm going to do it using this bazooka, right? I'm going to roll a tank down there, nobody's going to stop me, I will get it through as many times as you want, right? Voila. Of course, that's ridiculous, right? I mean, without rules, there is no creativity. There is no possibility of freedom. There is no possibility of rising above the constraints that exist there. So I would argue that freedom and constraints exist in a kind of reciprocal relationship. We have sometimes the notion that freedom means not having any obligations, not having any restrictions whatsoever, but that's not freedom, that's randomness. Right? That doesn't give you creativity, that doesn't give you thought, that doesn't give you anything really interesting. So, we find ourselves in this world and our bodies are constrained. We cannot fly, we cannot be everywhere. We cannot live forever. Lots of constraints. And yet, that's what makes it possible for us to create. So, Heidegger, Martin Heidegger, and this is somebody who you may have already talked about, so if I'm going over stuff you've already heard before, please forgive me, but Heidegger really is the best way into this. Heidegger talks about this notion of dwelling. And when he talks about dwelling, what he has in mind is not just living, not just, what's your address, or something like that. What he has in mind is this notion that we always find ourselves in a place that, as it were, calls us forth. We are a certain way in a certain place. And you can probably think of examples of this yourself, right, at a basic level. When you are at your parents' home, you're probably different from when you're in the club, or you're different from when you're traveling halfway around the world, or you're different from when you're here, right? You use a different language. You may even just kind of have incorporated certain ways of being in those places, and it becomes natural to you, and you move back and forth. If you have kind of if you find yourself in kind of multiple cultural spaces, you find that even more to be the case. If you're gay, you find yourself you have to be some certain ways sometimes and other ways other times. If you're African American or if you're Hispanic, you find yourself being certain ways sometimes and other ways other times. You know how to move between those worlds, and you embody, you dwell in those places in different ways. And so what Heidegger talks about, he wrote this essay called Building the Law of Thinking, right? Should be significant for all of us here, right? Because building is not what we're interested in. Dwelling and thinking come along with it. It's like those three are tied together. You can't do one without the other, right? So for Heidegger, here's how he cashes this out. He says, and this is going to seem a little bit weird, but I think once I explain it, it might be a little clearer. He talks about what he calls the earth, the sky, the gods, the mortals, okay? So this is what it means to dwell. You have to have all of these things enacted. All of these things are part of the notion of dwelling. So what's he trying to say? Earth, sky, gods, mortals. So you mean we have to become religious, gods? No, that's not really what he's talking about here, okay? What he's talking about is this, okay? I put it on a little grid up here. He's talking about the fact that we have to take into account both permanence and change, and we have to take into account both place and time. And so the sky is permanent, and it's about place. It's over all of us at all times. It's simultaneously over all of us, over all places. The earth is changing place. This is a different place than over here, right? So constantly changing. Sky is permanent, earth is not. Gods, they're permanent in terms of time. They're the thing, they're the beings that see all time as simultaneous. Right? That's where we get our notion of permanence from. That's where we get our notion of longevity from. That's where we start thinking about memory and what we pass down to other generations, things of that nature. Mortals, well, that's time that changes. Where we begin, we end. Right? We have a path through this life and we are not eternal. We are not going to do this, okay? And so Heidegger puts all of those things together to talk about what it means to dwell in a place. And the best way I can explain this is to use two examples he uses, both of them involving rivers. And I think I might have mentioned this summer, I don't remember, but I sketched it out a little bit more fully here. In another essay, he talks about dams, a dam. And look at what he says here, okay? The hydroelectric plant, he's talking about a dam on a river. The hydroelectric plant is set into the current of the Rhine. It sets the Rhine to supplying its hydraulic pressure, which then sets the turbines turning. This turning sets those machines in motion, whose thrust sets going the electric current for which the long-distance power stations networks of cables are set up to dispatch electricity. Do you notice how many times he used the word set, right? I mean, it's like an imposition. It's like this dam has been forced upon the river. And what it has done is forced the river into what he calls elsewhere in the essay, standing reserve. In other words, we've turned the river into plastic. Okay? You know what plastic is? It's something that has no form that you can make into anything. Right? It doesn't kick back. It's not like wood. It's not like you have to think about the grain or anything like that. And wood, you have to think, how do I negotiate with this wood if you're really good? You know, woodwork, you think about what is this wood going to let me do and what's not going to let me do. Plastic, don't have to think about that, right? It's just there to do whatever you want. It's not asking you any questions. It's not asking you, why do you want to do this? Or do you really think that's a good idea? Or do you have a skill to pull this off? You know, I'm not asking anything like that. All it is turned into a material that we think that we can master. And for Heidegger, this is a great example of how not to dwell, right? This is not dwelling in this world. This is taking command over the world. We are not of this world when we think like this. We think the world is beneath us, right? Compare that to the bridge. Here's how he talks about the bridge. The bridge swings over the stream with ease and power. It does not just connect the banks that are already there. The banks emerge as banks only as the bridge crosses the stream. That's amazing. There were no banks before there was a bridge. What's he talking about? Right? And yet what he's talking about is that in our lived experience, to live with the river rather than to impose ourselves on the river makes the river into something and forces us, just like with a piece of wood, to ask, what can I do and what can I not do? How can I respond to this place? How can I, what does this call forth from me? Who am I in this place? I am not God. I do not float above it. And so for Heidegger, you know, the bridge gathers to itself its own way, in its own way, earth and sky, divinities and mortals. Right? All those things I just talked about before. All of that stuff comes together because there is a negotiation with the earth and not simply an imposition upon it. We did not just take down every tree in the entire subdivision and plop up a few pine trees and make a few cul-de-sacs and there we go. Boom. Could be better. Could be anywhere in the world. We didn't ask, as it were, what the world wanted, and it did not call anything forth from us. So for Heidegger, that's the sense of dwelling. That's a great example of this phenomenological notion that I'm talking about. A great deal of the writing you see, especially in architecture, on place, comes from this tradition. Right? A great number of people write within this tradition, which asks, how do we live with the world and not simply dominate the world? Okay. So building, dwelling, and thinking all come together because of this. We do not just construct machines for living. Sorry, the purpose here. But we come to consciousness by building well. We show ourselves, or at least a version of ourselves, as we build. So, for example, let's suppose that you've been asked to design a classroom. And you design the best possible classroom you can. How do you know it's the best possible classroom you can? Because you've been in a whole bunch of classrooms, right? You know the classrooms you like and the classrooms you don't like. You might look around at this one and say, it's not bad, it's pretty good. If I was designing it, I might do some things differently. I might not put that pole there, for example. And by the way, if you think that pole's bad, come to my department for a bit and you'll see a pole right in the middle of our lecture room for some reason that I don't understand. and we actually work with the architects. So you would design your classroom. And you say, this is the best possible classroom I can design given, you know, the constraints that I have and all the rest of that. Somebody comes along 20 years from now and says, I can do better. And so what do they say? Are they saying that you're a bad architect? No, not really. See, the fact is, we only understand the world by living in it. We understand classrooms by being in classrooms. You can design all you want in your head, but there's nothing kicking back. There's nothing saying, you know, when I live in this place, you know, after I've been here for a little while, oh, this thing is annoying, this thing is really great, and I didn't even realize it would be, and all the rest of that stuff. You don't know that until you live in it, and you bring that life experience to the next thing that you do, but the fact is, you are not immortal, and you are not God, and you do not have all experience in the world. Somebody else is going to come along and say, here's something you didn't see, here's something you missed, right? And that's how interesting building is done, right? It is a process of living in this world. And so that's really what Heidegger and others in the phenomenological tradition are after. How do we create our experience of the world? If you don't have experience in the world, that's going to be a problem because you need something to bring to that building. All right, let me move on. So the first one was phenomenology and hermeneutics. The second one is sign, symbols, and structure, or what I called earlier semiotics and structuralism. And this is really a different approach to place. And I've used an example here from Valentin Madimbe. And he takes it off of Michel Desserteau. As a street is a place that a walker transforms into an active space, or as a text is a locus of organized signs obeying the logic of a proper place that every reader can change into an intellectual or aesthetic space of learning and enjoyment, so the object of anthropological curiosity, he's an anthropologist, constitutes a place with its proper rules that the anthropologist's activity and interpretation transforms into a new space. What is he saying here? What he's saying is, you know, whereas the phenomenologists think that place is the lived experience and space is a kind of abstraction, there's a kind of reversal or inversion here. In this notion, place comes first. Place is just the stuff that's around, right? Think about a downtown street, right? Let me click forward to some downtown streets, okay? So got a bunch of different streets here, right? And the place, which is the stuff, becomes a space. And what is meant by space is a set of opportunities and a set of possibilities. Okay? And so, 10 o'clock Monday morning, what kind of space is downtown Orlando? Well, it's probably a business space, right? It's a space that certain kinds of things happen. It's the kind of space where you and your body just kind of walking around know how to behave for the most part. You know, you put yourself in that place, and you know it's appropriate, and you know it's not appropriate, right? 10 o'clock on Saturday night, it's the same place, but it's a different space. Different stuff happens, right? I mean, you know, it's party time. It's all sorts of stuff happens, and you know that, you know, I'm not going to go down there dressed like this, probably. So, same place, right? Same buildings, same streets, same stuff, different space, right? Because it's imbued by different, one thinker called different habitus, different sets of kind of inbred sorts of meanings that we just make in the world. I mean, you can see habitus every time you walk around any kind of major campus and look at the lawns and see where the paths go, right? You know, where they didn't think to put any concrete, you know, and then you see a path going somewhere and you realize, there's something about this place that makes people want to go there. There's a story there, right? There's a story at least of, you know, people wanting to get from point A to point B, and they probably have some purposes in that. They probably have some reasons for doing that, right? And, you know, place becomes imprinted. We start reading that stuff, you know? And here's the other thing. We could read that stuff simultaneously differently. That downtown space at 10 o'clock on a Monday morning can be a vastly different place to a middle-aged white guy like me versus a woman, versus somebody from a different culture who doesn't speak the language. I mean, the reading is different. It's all reading. It's all about reading. But we read it differently. We have different vocabularies. We have different syntax. We have different everything. Right? That's the space for that guy right there. You know, a homeless person probably has a very different read on exactly the same space I would be walking around in. Right? So there is a certain sense that when we are making place, we don't have access to all of these. You know, and obviously there could be many more that we could talk about. That downtown space could be read in vastly many different ways. We can try and control those things. We can try and make the vocabulary very, very limited. This is a bash on the strip malls again. There is a limited vocabulary of place, right? There's one thing that you're supposed to do there, and that's shop. Come shop, go away. It's not a complex place. It's not a layered place. It may become layered. People may use it for other reasons. People may use it as a hangout. People may use it as other things. But everything about the place tells you that it's supposed to be used in one way and not other ways. And so the vocabulary of the place is a relatively limited one, as opposed to, let's say, a park, which might, its vocabulary, what, you know, the signifiers that we put out there may tell us this is to be used in multiple different ways. It's not just for shopping. It's not just for this one thing. It's not just for this particular class of people or that class of people. You know, famously, there are very subtle ways of signaling place divisions. Famously, Robert Moses in New York, when he was designing the highway system and the subways and the bridge system, made the underpasses that went out to certain areas of town too low for buses to go under. Right? So what's the effect of that?
So we got no buses.
No buses are going to go there. Who's going to ride those buses? Well, the people who ride buses are not the people you want out there. In other words, that's the implication, right? And so by that very simple design feature, you know, we have segregated society, we have a segregated world. People in cars go there, people in buses don't. You know, it's not explicitly about race, it's not explicitly about class, but it's about race and class. So, you know, this notion of place is very much about the world as a text, the world as a place, a thing that we read. And that reading is not like your typical book, which is written in a single language. This is written in multiple languages when we read it differently. You know, we see different things in it. So, number three, socially constructed place. person to note here is Henri Lefebvre, or what called the production of space. And in it, he talked about three different notions of place that he talked about as a trialectic. In other words, these three things come together. Each one of them assumes the other two. And so he talked about what he called perceived space. Think of it as physical place, right? Very much like the place notion of the earlier idea. He talked about conceived space, or think of it as mental place. So a blueprint or the matrix, right? And then he talked about what he called lived space, or representational space, or social place, right? And he said, being the good Marxist that he was, he said that what we do not take into account when we think about places quite often is their production and their the people who are engaged in them, right? We do not think about the people who are required to make a place what it is. We behave as if they just spring fully formed, you know? Do you know who Thomas Kincaid is, the artist? Kind of paints very kind of hyper-real sorts of images of traditional and kind of small-town America. So they tried to build a community. Thomas Kincaid tried to build a community in California called Hidden Brook. And it was going to be on the lines of this sort of kind of place. And it's a very kind of, you know, Victorian, cottagey, you know, really supposed to tug at your heartstrings of traditional America and all of these. And the colors of these paintings are just, you know, like really pop out at you. It's very kind of hyper-real. So they built this place, and what they found was, A, it was too expensive for anyone to buy. And number two, you couldn't pull it off this kind of illusion of homeliness without having a small army of probably immigrant laborers to keep it all in order, right? Now, Lefebvre is going to tell us, in order to know place, you have to know about those people. Not just about that nice little picture in front of you that says, oh, isn't this cute? This is what it really means to be American, you know, to live in a cottage like this. You have to know about the people who have to live. You have to know about the people who have to live somewhere in order so that they can come and get your home and can take care of your pool and your garden and all the rest of that. The places have all of that as part of them as well, right? It's a larger infrastructure. So Lefebvre tries to talk about the implications of what happens when all of those things really are taken into account, when we really do see the notion that place is an interconnected social web and not simply a kind of thing standing before us. So the final kind of category that I came up with here is environmental psychology, and it's what I called a psychological indeterminist notion of place. And the reason I called it that is because it's very much about the notion that the design of places produces a certain sense, a certain kind of consciousness in someone. Okay, and this is very much the notion of design that you will find in corporate America, for example. I mean, my favorite example is you know, McDonald's design. That actually is a McDonald's, believe it or not. You know, designs are made in order to produce certain kinds of behaviors in people, and those designs may be architectural designs, or they may be simply internal. Interior designs. It may be something as simple as where things are put on the grocery shelf for you to see or not see. They may be traffic flow patterns. They may be colors. They may be smells. They may be sounds. They may be any number of things that are meant to either suggest to you, for example, get your food, eat it, and get out quickly, or lounge around, spend more money, or this is a fun place, or this is a mysterious place. I mean, there are all sorts of ways that we have signaling those sorts of codes that produce certain kinds of effects in people. Whole area of, you know, study that gets into this sort of thing. So in environmental psychology, they break it down into looking at the idea of attention. Understanding human behavior starts with understanding how people notice the environment, what they notice and what they don't notice. Perceptual and cognitive mapping. How do we map our world? You know, I sometimes get my students to draw a map of their Orlando, and it's always interesting to me what they include and what they don't. Right? So it's essentially a cognitive map that they give me. But then we talk about, you know, things like scale, things like, you know, what they put in and what they didn't put in and all the rest of that. Environmental stress and coping. Places can produce stressors that lead to illness and other effects. preferred environments. People seek out places where they feel competent or confident, where they can make sense of the environment while also being engaged with it. Environments need complexity and mystery for this, and so I put Hogwarts. Which seems to me to be exactly the kind of design movie makers are great at this sort of thing. I mean, you know, you want to see place design writ large, you just watch some really kind of epic movies, you build, you know, an enormous amount of attention is paid to places as characters in movies. And so Hogwarts is exactly that, right? Hogwarts in the Harry Potter movies really is a place of mystery and opportunity and intrigue and danger, but it is supposed to be a place of someone coming to maturity. You know, it's just that classic sort of notion of the place. You hardly even have to know anything about the story. You just need to look at the place in the interior, and you probably would come up with something like that description without having read anything or seen it. So, and they talk about participation, the notion that, and this now gets into a kind of method or procedure, the notion that consequences of all these factors is that design and architecture needs to involve people in the initial design of places and conservation behavior. So I put the juxtaposition of these two things to think about what it means to conserve. So all of this has to do with identity. That was a quick trip through some theoretical stuff, but all of this has to do with notions of identity in different ways. By identity, I mean the question of who we are. And you know, it may not seem on the surface like architecture has anything to do with that, but the fact is it does, right? Anytime we build, we are saying something about who we are. We are maybe trying to extend a certain kind of national image of who we are, or a personal image. We are coming to some form of identity, as we talked about in the phenomenological approach with dwelling. We are reading the environment. We're thinking about what it takes to maintain a place or to come to place. And we're talking about the kind of causal effects of place as well. So place turns out to be quite a complex sort of notion, right? I mean, when we're thinking about what it means to produce something, all of this stuff is rattling around in the back of our heads, whether we realize it or not, because all of this is part of the places that we've experienced. So, you know, what I want to argue here is that these things don't just come in kind of cafeteria style. It's not just that you kind of get them all together and can put in the parts that you want. Because, in fact, like I said earlier, they actually tend to undermine or conflict with each other. So, for example, the hermeneutical and the symbolic and structural approaches, the first one stands as a kind of what I call an inner approach, and the symbolic and structural comes as a, what I'm going to call an outer approach, and it's all about the question of the location of meaning. Where is meaning located? Well, if it exists in the world out there, if it's in the signs that are embedded in the world, that's what we're talking about here, right? It's out there. We're reading. For Heidegger, it's not out there, right? What's out there brings us out, you know? Our attitude towards the river makes us into somebody. And meaning is in here. We haven't found it yet. You know, we don't know what it is yet, but our action in the world makes us into something. And so you can see these two things, in some sense, stand in sort of tension with each other, right? If the world out there is the world of meaning, you know, and all we have to do is read it, then that's, you know, we're not asking about who we are particularly. We're asking about how we stand in that nexus of signifiers and flows and all the rest of that. You know, where does it make sense for me to be? If, on the other hand, we're thinking about who we are and what it means to come to ourselves, you know, that's not about reading out there, that's about us being something here. So you can see there's a tension between these two things. And there's a similar tension between these two, constructivism and psychological approach. There's kind of a before and after sort of tension here. The social constructivist approach assumes that place is constructed or being produced by something else. It's located after the material or symbolic structures of the world. Whereas the psychological approach assumes that place produces subjectivity, right? You get the place right and then you become something, at least in a limited sense or a local sense. So there are similarities between the two. And I'm not going to talk too much about this because I am running out of time here, so I want to get a little bit forward, move a little bit further here. Talk a little bit about how places can fail as places. Right? If everything I've said so far means anything, it's not true that place is just, you know, a physical location or a GPS coordinates or something like that. It is possible that places may, in fact, fail as places. They can fail to fulfill their intended purpose. They can be boring. They can be unaware of or uncaring about their context. They can be non-places, and I'm going to talk about that in a moment. They can be limited by the imagination of their clients, architects, regulatory boards, etc. They can fail to recognize the complexity of place and try to fit too narrow or scripted a view of place. Let me talk about non-place for a second. This is an anthropologist named Marc Auger. And Auger wrote this book called Non-Places. And in it, the first example he uses is the example of an airport. What he says about the airport is it's a place, and he's very much in the kind of symbolic structuralist sort of camp that I described here. The airport is a place where all of the signifiers point somewhere else. Right? It's not a place where you come to, I mean, people may come to it to work there, but everything, you know, if you're going through that place, you are going there in order to get somewhere else. You are not going there as a destination for the most part. Now, that's changing, of course, in airports. Auger wrote this probably 10, 15 years ago. And there are airports that are designing themselves as destinations. But for the most part, it's always about getting somewhere else. And so what Auger says is that it's a kind of non-place. And he uses bus terminals and other things in the same sort of sense. It's not something that invests in meaning in itself. It's pointing to meaning that exists somewhere else. You have to go somewhere. The whole point is to get out of here. It's not to stay here. But I have an example I like even better, and that's the mall. So this is the West Edmonton Mall. I used to go there all the time because I taught just south of Edmonton. That's the water park that is in the mall. Has 11 slides. This is the what they call the European area. You might think of each of these as stores. Actually, they're not stores. They're groups of stores. So in the J here, there's probably 40 stores. West Edmonton Mall has 800 stores on two levels. It has this water park. It has four roller coasters in an amusement park. It has a full-size, NHL-size skating rink. It has three submarines. It has a church, hotel. What else? A lot of other stuff. I forgot what all it has. It's crazy. It's just incredibly big. And I used to love to go there just for the spectacle of it. You know, it was designed in the 70s when the airs were in, and so there was a certain sense that you could walk through the place and see yourself shopping, right? Not shopping, right? And it's almost like this sort of hyper-real sort of situation where you are in this place, which is a simulacrum of other places. After all, most malls are designed, at least conceptually, around some notion of the city downtown from decades ago, and this has that sensibility to it. There are, you know, this is Bourbon Street right here. So it has, you know, restaurants and music places and so forth. But this whole thing is like a big long esplanade or a big long kind of a main street with shops on both sides. And so that's supposed to be echoing in the back of your mind, but it's a simulacrum of all of that. It feels fake, even though it can be an exciting place. Now, what's interesting to me is that how ambiguous a space it is. I mean, let's think about the first two forms of place that I was talking about, dwelling and this symbolic and structural place. Is this a dwelling place? A lot of people will say, no. I mean, it's a mockery of a dwelling place. Right? I mean, I know people who went there, just kind of went in and bought what they needed and went out again. It was a place that gave the heebie-jeebies, you know, because it just felt like a mockery of any place that used to be any kind of downtown, you know, place that had locally owned businesses or anything like that. This was just a big, the whole thing was kind of an amusement park. So it wasn't a dwelling place for many people. For other people, it was what you might call a scene. People would go there to hang out. You'd meet your friends there, right? It was a place. It was a different kind of place. It was not a dwelling place for other people, but it was a different kind of place that had all those semiotic signifiers to them. Not only the architectural design features, but the habitus features. You know how scenes work, you know? You know how the music scene works, the, you know, different little scenes. People are in the group and out of the group. There's differential access. You have to be, you know, wear the right clothes or say the right things or have the right amount of money or do this or do that, and then you're in. And if you don't have all of that stuff, then you're not in, right? And scenes are like that. They have these kind of differential shifting borders, but they operate like places. People know how to navigate them. People know how to make sense out of themselves while they're in them. And so they function like places in a place like this, which is a kind of backdrop, but it's not a dwelling. It's not a dwelling. you know? And so there's this funny tension. It is a place, and yet it's not a place. Right? It's a mockery of a place, and yet it's a real place, depending on what we mean by place. So this, to me, is the really interesting part. I'm going to wrap up here. There's a couple more slides, but I think better to have a couple minutes for discussion. This is what's really interesting about place, to me, because once you start drilling down into the uses of the term, you realize that places can both be places and not places at the same time for different people. You realize that we use the word in so many different ways, and we want it to accomplish so many different things for us, that, you know, if you're standing at the front end of it, if you're standing at the design end, how do I make a place? You got a lot of things to consider. You know, it's one thing to stand at the other end. Here is a place that someone designed. Now I'm going to live in it. And, you know, what will it take to do that? Can I do it the way evidently the designer intended, or do I have to make workarounds? Is it a place for me, or is it a place not for me? You know, was I intended to be part of this, or wasn't I? Right? So it's one thing to talk about the place from that vantage point. If you're this side, designing it, it's an incredibly ambitious task to make good places. And yet, you know, you can do it. I mean, a lot of architects make incredible places. And we have some real duds out there too.